All right, welcome everyone to our second scholar session. Before we get started, I'd like to ask you all to keep yourselves on mute until we reach the Q&A portion of the program tonight. You can add your questions to the chat box along the way, and then when we get to the Q&A portion, my colleague Joan Cummins will either read your question or invite you to ask your question yourself using your own voice. It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Medford and Dr. Burton this evening. Please note that in the interest of getting to the conversation more quickly, I'm going to give abbreviated bios for them. And trust me, I can use the whole hour speaking about just their careers and the things they've done. But you can find more complete biographies for them, including published works, on the event page for this program on our website. Dr. Edna Greene Medford is the Associate Provost for Faculty Affairs and Professor of History at Howard University, a school she's been affiliated with for over 30 years. She has an undergraduate degree in secondary education from Hampton Institute, now Hampton University. She earned her MA from the University of Illinois at Urbana and her PhD from the University of Maryland, College Park. Both of her graduate degrees are in US history. And Dr. Medford has authored and edited numerous books and scholarly articles on the topics of slavery, the Civil War, and Reconstruction. She's contributed to the field in a wide variety of other ways, including by serving on national advisory boards and contributing to historical documentaries. Dr. Medford has received many awards recognizing her work, including a special bicentennial edition of the Order of Lincoln, awarded by the state of Illinois in 2009 to commemorate the 200th anniversary of President Lincoln's birth. Dr. Medford was also our inaugural chair of our scholarly advisory group here at President Lincoln's Cottage. Dr. Orville Vernon Burton is the Judge Matthew J. Perry Distinguished Chair of History and Professor of Pan-African Studies, Sociology, and Anthropology, and Computer Science at Clemson University, where he is also the director of the Clemson CyberInstitute. His research interests lie in American history, and particularly in community and race relations in the American South, and the intersection of humanities and social science. Dr. Burton has authored and edited numerous digital humanities projects and scholarly journals and books, such as his Pulitzer-nominated book, The Age of Lincoln. He has been recognized on many occasions for these works, as well as for his teaching. He continues to contribute to the field through teaching, scholarship, service on various advisory boards, and through the facilitation of lectures, presentations, and workshops. We're delighted to have both of you here with us this evening, virtually. Tonight isn't unique in that we're going to be focusing our conversation on preconceptions and meaning of Confederate iconography, monuments, and memorials, but it is unique in that this isn't just a conversation in response to recent events, both the killing of unarmed Black citizens by mostly white police officers or ex-police officers, as well as the protests across the country and around the world, which have called for both systemic change and a reckoning for the symbols, the monuments, memorials, and flags of white supremacy, many of which relate to the Civil War era. What makes our conversation tonight also different is that we've already had it, 5 years ago, in fact. I want you all to think back to where you were in the summer of 2015. Vernon and Edna, you graciously gave us your time back then, and we spoke in the wake of the Confederate flag being taken down at the State House in South Carolina, following the murder of 9 parishioners at Mother Emanuel Church in Charleston at that time. Edna, I'd like to start with you. One of the things you said back in 2015 was that you were encouraged by the change in the flag coming down, et cetera. But you said, quote, "I think this movement that we're seeing at the moment, I'm afraid it's not permanent." And you continued with, "I'm afraid people saw it as the right thing to do because the shooting was so horrific, but people will forget and go back to where we were. It's the underlying issues." So I'd like to start by asking you, what has been permanent? What has changed in those 5 years? And have we made any progress on these underlying issues?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think a lot has changed and a lot has remained the same as well. What has changed is that African-Americans and people who are very much concerned about the conditions of people of color and just poor people in general have come together to try to make changes in a way that I think is going to be difficult for anyone to sort of intervene and stop the momentum. But things have gotten much worse as well. I was concerned at the time that there would be a backlash because there were certain changes moving in the right direction. And certainly we have experienced that backlash. The last 5 years have been very difficult, especially for people of color and for folk who are attempting to help turn us in another direction, in the right direction, I feel. But I think that I'm encouraged this time as well, because we know that the last time the changes occurred because of the shooting in Charleston, things are changing very quickly this time because of a similar kind of violence. But I think it's been the response to it has been sustained for a much longer period of time than I had anticipated. And I was looking the other day at just an image of the people who are out demonstrating, who are protesting what has happened in this country, what continues to happen. And I was struck by the fact of how diverse the group was. And so I am encouraged by that. But again, as I was 5 years ago, I'm a bit concerned that it's the flavor of the moment, that people have been galvanized because they saw the death of a man on camera. Many people have died since 2015, and it didn't have this kind of outpouring. There was a bit of it, but to actually see someone lose his life on camera, I think is what's made the difference. I don't know that that's going to be enough to sustain this momentum. I hope it does. I hope this is real change, but I'm not sure that that's what we're going to see within the next 2 or 3 years. Hmm.
Thanks, Edna. Vernon, I'd like to hear your take on that. And you also brought up the concern about a backlash last time, both in this country, but also, given what you were seeing on the campus where you teach as well.
Well, actually, I'm very hopeful, and perhaps even more hopeful than last time. You might remember that I argued that one of the things happened with the flag coming down, it was not just the massacre, as horrible as that was, because your legislature, which had to vote on this with the Heritage Act, with a two-thirds or three-fourths, I forget which kind of majority, had been the same one. And all these things that they heard had said before, I really think what made the difference there, why I was worried it may not last, is that the families of the people who had been massacred actually spoke about grace and forgiveness. And ironically, I think that really resonated across a culture of religion. That's one of the few things that blacks and white really shared in many ways, or they've used it differently in the South. So what I think now I see is exactly what Edna said, and that is people saw George Floyd die. And it reminded me of the civil rights movement. I actually think this is different than the Charleston massacre, which sort of began it. Then we saw Charlottesville and other things along the way. But I really think, like the civil rights movement, this could be a revolutionary moment and a revolutionary time. And part of it is something that's been going on since I went to graduate school, before most of you were born. And that is that we are getting our history better. And places like the Lincoln Cottage are conveying that history better. People have been misled in extraordinary ways in their interpretation of history. And we now have close to at least 10 or 20 years of public high school teachers. And these public high school teachers, I say, are doing God's work, bless them, that they have taught history about not just slavery, but particularly Reconstruction, this period of interracial democracy, the much more the truth of what had happened than what people have been told. That is, white Southerners, former Confederates or children of former Confederates and others wrote a history that was not truthful, but it became the history. It was accepted. That became part of the Klansman and Birth of a Nation, history written with lightning, as Woodrow Wilson said, through Gone with the Wind. And that was generation after generation. And now we are beginning from the rewriting of history, which is not actually rewriting or revising it, but the correcting of the story, looking at what the evidence is and telling it. So I am more hopeful and actually think that this, like the civil rights movement, is a special time. I'm not quite sure how to compare it with the 5 years ago. That was a massacre.
Yeah.
It was a time of trauma and broader, but this is a time, I think, of change. Mm-hmm. It started then, but I think we really now are beginning to put it all together in a way that we can understand how we got to where we are. That it's not just slavery ended racism. That the Voting Rights Act in 1965, the great John Lewis has just passed on. And think about this. John Lewis would not have been allowed to vote. He couldn't go to Troy University. I mean, this was 1965. How long I like to tell people, this new book we're doing, I talk about the 14 generations, figuring 25 years as a generation. We have had 12 generations of white privilege through the laws. Really, it's not till 65, 68, you begin to get rid of it. And we've had 2 generations of not. And I really think some of that is taking effect and it's coming together in a very exciting way. And I do think that things are going to happen. We will always have backlash, though. And Edna's right. The media helped publicize George Floyd, but there is a media empire that spins things in ways, and if you're only looking at that one media outlet, you're getting a very different story.
Yeah. And that's,
you can't even make up your own mind without having the facts presented to you. It's the best we can do and be objective, but the media works in other ways too. So we'll have to see, but I'm more hopeful than I've ever been.
That's great. That's good perspective too. And I'd like to pick up on something that you just talked about, Vernon, that also came up in some of your comments, Edna. And it's this, you know, talking about the dialogue that we can and need to have, but also how our perspective can change. And then you also mentioned, Vernon, this idea of you know, the history that has been told for years, and years ago we all talked about how the North was likewise complicit in the Lost Cause narrative. So one of the common refrains you hear when people call to take down, you know, monuments or memorials or rename things is that doing that is erasing history. Or, you know, similarly, that attempts to tell maybe a more complete story that might contradict previous versions, that's revisionist history. As highly respected historians, how would you respond to that? We can start with you, Edna.
That's me. Okay. Sure. No, I don't think that removing a symbol is erasing history. I don't believe in destroying these monuments. I think you remove them, you put them in a proper location, you put them in a museum, and if they're too large for a museum, you create a park just for them. I think a park of that nature does exist somewhere, either in this country or elsewhere. And I think you can do that, and it gives us all the opportunity to look at the history of these symbols in a different way. If you have a monument on the sidewalk or on public property, people are not going to stop to read what might be on this thing. They're going to pass it and they're going to assume, okay, this is a monument to a great person. You're not going to take the time to find out what this person did that he would be celebrated in this way. But if you take it down, you put it someplace where you can actually explain the complete history of this, that's very different. But I don't believe in destroying. I was taken aback recently when I learned that there was this attempt in Washington to remove the Freedmen's Memorial from Lincoln Park. I thought that was very ill-advised, to say the least. That's an understatement. People need to understand first the history of that monument. It was built by formerly enslaved people, many of them veterans who had fought for their freedom and for the freedom of their people. They paid for that monument. Does the monument represent Black people the way I would like to see it? No, it does not. Did the people who paid for it have any say in how it looked? No, they did not. But it's supposed to be a celebration of freedom. And I don't think you take that down. You cannot see that in the same light that you would a monument to a Confederate general. They're two very different things. But if people are concerned about what that monument seems to suggest in terms of the role of Black people and their own liberation or lack thereof, then you put something else beside it and you show what the true story is. That one you don't take down. The others you can take down and put elsewhere. Destroying them serves no purpose from my perspective. And you're certainly not shortchanging history by removing them. You're not erasing history at all. You are acknowledging that there is a problem with this symbol in a country that is supposed to be wedded to the idea of liberty, justice, and equality for all people.
Thanks, Edna. Vernon, your thoughts?
Yeah, and you know, I agree with everything Edna said and emphasized. I think each monument must be looked at separately, each plaque, each historic house. And I've said this before, I think I said it the last time we talked. You know, people don't learn their history from the books that we historians write, or my grandchildren have a lot larger educational fund, but they do learn it from the Lincoln Cottage, from the monuments we put up, from the public history we tell. That is where it comes from. That's why I have such an affinity for Illinois, because the land of Lincoln. And I think that's a great message versus the land of Calhoun in South Carolina or Clemson. And so there's a way to do it. But you need to look at each one. And I am reminded of the judge when he went back and sort of pardoned the Friendship Nine. These were the first students who went to jail and didn't take bail in Rock Hill, South Carolina. And they accused him of rewriting history. He says, no, you cannot rewrite history, but you can right, R-I-G-H-T, a wrong. And I think that's a good distinction that we need to make. You have to ask at each memorial, when did it go up? Who put it up? What were their purposes? What was it about? You have to look at a person, if you're looking at people. I was part of that generation that sort of helped destroy the idea of heroes in history, and we might have been wrong. You know, when we learned that Jefferson at that time, we weren't even sure, but we knew he was a slave, probably had a mistress who was underage, that is, what else can you call it, wrong? We didn't even have genetics. Then we sort of started throwing the baby out with the bathwater. I think you've got to look at the total contribution of an individual. What was their arc of their life like? What is it? And take the good with the bad. I think that's one of the things to it. The other thing is, when people are talking about art, very few of these Confederate monuments are true art. Believe me, they were just, they had like a plaster Paris, little forms, and just pumped them out as fast as they could and sent them out. Now, there may be some that truly are art, and those I think should probably be preserved. But we have to remember these are put up. And here's something that I have started talking about recently and put in this recent book I'm writing. And that is, what does it mean? In every in nearly every courthouse square in the South, in front of the courthouse, is a statue to the Confederacy, often with words that ring out white supremacy. Clearly, they were erected with that in mind. But what that is basically saying, as I said, if John Lewis couldn't vote in 1965, or to go into the courthouse where you may have to arrest you was a getting in trouble, even if it was good trouble for John Lewis, then that is still a symbol to many people to say, don't expect to get a fair share here and justice here. This is built. There's a symbol here of white supremacy. Nowhere on public land should there be the kind of statues that send that message. Now, I am perfectly happy if people want to buy the land and put it somewhere or in a graveyard that's kept by the Daughters of the Confederacy, they put it up. I'm not saying not to display it. It doesn't mean something, but there are many of them that have rather offensive language. Some don't, but there are some of them that are very explicit what it's about. And I think that when you're paying taxes as a citizen and that is offensive to you, it shouldn't be there. I mean, yeah. I'm not talking about a personal offense, but to you as a group of people and citizens in a democracy. So I think those are some of the things you want to think about when we look at them. I'm happy to elaborate, but yeah. I hope I'm being clear.
Vernon, I actually think that's a great thing to elaborate on because there are two different things, and I know that there are many different ways to look at meaning, but you've raised both the context of where it is, you know, if it's like in front of a court, for example, or the legislature, public land versus private, and also when it was put up.
So and why? They made it clear why it was put up.
Yeah. Yeah. So when, why, and where? Can you talk a little bit more about the themes of that behind a lot of these monuments and memorials and the naming of things that are coming up now?
Oh, absolutely. One of the things is, let me just point out that the Confederate monuments, and you can deal with all of these. You have Native American and so many other things, but they're not just about honoring our dead soldiers, which is what we hear. They were also a part of the American South, white South, refocusing the narrative of the Civil War. They died defending Southern liberty and freedom from an oppressed central government in Washington. And the monuments are all put up the height of Jim Crowism. 1890 to 1915, 1920 is the height of it. And part of it is, this is we talked about a little time, last time before, it's a reconciliation of North and South too, at the expense of particularly African-Americans, leaving out the African-American soldiers who Lincoln said made the difference in winning that war, that it's the reunion of the soldiers. It's ironic to me, you know, that Robert E. Lee said, let's furl the flag, never fly it again, let's build no monuments. It's, if there was to be a monument, Robert E. Lee should say, this is the man who said, let's don't have monuments and, you know, and furl the flag and let's listen to him maybe. But that's not the way, ironically, his monument has been put up. And people were pretty explicit about what they were doing and going up. As I said, this is where people learn their history. I've looked at all the Southern State House grounds. The South Carolina one, I have to be careful, got a 50-minute lecture on it and don't let me launch into it. But every single statue up or of an individual there, there is not one African American, and every one of them either argued strongly for white supremacy, were owned slaves, and were against the civil rights movement and against Brown v. Board, were leading segregation. And I used to give this lecture and say, nowhere is there a name of African American on the State House ground. I had to change that because I think it was really the appropriate thing to do and they should be credited for it. Strom Thurmond's family added his African American daughter's name to the list of children. So there is an African American name, but it's not exactly the way that, you know, when we have people like the great Benjamin E. Mays or the wonderful Congressman Robert Smalls, I mean, so many contributions and things. And children, as I said, I was a generation that worked so hard to get rid of the idea of heroes, but I've changed my mind. I think we need role models, and at least alternative role models. I don't want to tell people how to think, but how do they know there were always blacks and whites in the southern states, in every state I've ever looked, at every place that I have ever looked, who stood against the grain? And it goes against this idea too, well, that was a different time. We thought different. You'll find some of the most anti-racist white people you'll ever find in your life living the most courageous lives at that time period. So what does that say about the excuse that, well, that was a different time?
Right.
You didn't know better. So that's part of it. Did I go off track on you there?
No, that's good. And I'd like your comments on that too, about how the place and the why and the where affects the meaning of these things too.
Yeah. I do want to say that I
am not against people having for what it means to them. And I'm not even doubting that. And I think we need to be sensitive to this, that it is important to people and they believe this. Mm-hmm. You're not going to stop them from believing it by yelling at them, actually. And we need to engage in dialogue of what it means to others. I love Harvey Gantt, the later mayor of Charlotte, ran against Jesse Helms, but he integrated Clemson first school. And he once said that if you can't appeal to the morals of a South Carolinian, you can appeal to his manners. And it's gone a long way when I explain to people, do you know that this is hurting other people's feelings? Do you really want to do that?
Yeah.
On public property. You can do what you want to other places, but when it's public property, taxpayers' property, then that's a very different thing than you having the personal right to be wrong. And I think you are wrong.
I like that, the personal right to be wrong. Edna, go ahead.
Yeah, sure. I should point out that Vernon was one of my very first graduate professors. And I remember distinctly, we had a conversation in class once where he was asking me to give my views on Aldrich Phillips's American Negro Slavery. I don't know if you remember that, Vernon. And I took the position that there was nothing worth knowing about Aldrich Phillips because he was a racist. And because of the history that he wrote, that was inaccurate from my perspective. And Vernon taught me as a historian to be objective. Mm. And I have always attempted to do that, but as an African-American woman, it is very difficult to be objective when you're confronted with a monument to someone like a Lee or a Jackson or whomever, who was so intimately associated with the Confederacy, or even someone like Thomas Jefferson, who can be seen by the average American as a great statesman. And as a historian, I can see him that way as well. But as an African American, I have to remember that this man who claimed that Americans were entitled to certain rights did not extend those rights to people of my color. And so it is very difficult to separate oneself and say, well, this was a great American. He just made a mistake here. His whole attitude about Black people, his willingness to enslave Black people, tarnishes his reputation from my perspective. And so it's very difficult to see him in any other way or to see any of these Confederate monuments in any other way. You know, I thought long and hard about whether or not we can at least tolerate a monument to a Confederate soldier, just an average Confederate soldier who had nothing to do directly with the war except to fight the war. And it is very difficult for me, although I understand that these people fought for what they believed was right. What they believed was right was wrong. And I don't know that we can ever just excuse that. And so I would be in favor of removing any kind of monument that supports the idea of a glorious cause for the Confederacy or a glorious cause for the Southern people. People who supported the leaving the nation, you know, not being willing to accept their country and creating another country because they wanted to continue practices that did damage to a whole race of people. Yes, states' rights was certainly a part of it, but it was also about supporting a society based on slavery. And that's something that's very difficult for me to get around.
Yeah.
Let me just add one thing. There's only one place I disagree with anything you say, Edna, and that is, I think a lot of those common soldiers did not believe in their cause. I really do. I think that's part of the myth we created. It finally, we're getting some novels and some history to show that as well. That there were, you know, the desertion was not just because wanting to go home, but figuring out what this war was. Mm-hmm. And I've often said that the big mistake was when people accuse me of having misunderstood Lincoln when I argued that, he was a Southerner, didn't ride the South. Well, they said, well, he thought that, Southerners, common Southerners would not, those who owned slaves would not fight for a war against slavery. But remember, Lincoln defined the war at first not about ending slavery. And Edna has explained that very well in her books, which I was happy to get to be a reader of and things, but about preserving the Union. And it became then a war about slavery. I've often wondered what would happen now if, in fact, Lincoln has said, we're going to end this war against slavery. I don't think he'd have been able to have got a corporal's guard to go down from the North to fight the war. And I'm absolutely sure, in fact, we'll never know whether Southerners would have fought if they knew the war initially that they were fighting for was not about, their ability to leave the Union, but there to go to end slavery. And I think part of it, when it became a war to end slavery, a lot did desert. So I think part of the myth is this commitment to it. I've had this argument with a lot of the sons of the Confederacy. You're dishonoring my great grandfather. I said, your great grandfather was drafted. He did not want to go. They had to come and find him under the wagon, and then he deserted. So, just how much do you want to honor this place? He wasn't about to honor it. He got forced into it. And we forget that. The South was divided. When you take all the black soldiers who fought for the Union, who came out of the South, and every single state except for South Carolina had a regiment of white Unionists who fought. And those in South Carolina ran off to Tennessee, Georgia, North Carolina, enjoyed joint Union things. So we created this myth of a unified white Southerner who was committed to slavery and all of the other things. It just was not true.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Vernon,
I'll let you win this one.
No, I don't have to win. We can disagree. But I think we're playing into people's hands when we say, we don't do it, because I really do believe, now maybe, and a lot, and most people don't agree with me, but I do think an elite group of slave owning and many who had visions of empire, slave empire, and spreading slavery, because everywhere in the world except the United States was going back toward monarchy. That's why Lincoln's last best hope, he really meant it, that democracy was failing everywhere. Napoleon back on the throne, Maximilian, he's putting in Mexico, all had been republics or democracies. Mm-hmm. And so these white Confederate leaders had a vision of this very elite group that democracy doesn't work. At any rate,
yeah.
Enough, that has nothing to do with monuments.
No, I think it does, because it gets to also where we started, where we were talking about the symbols versus maybe the systemic change that's needed. And so I think that that's a good question for us to end on before we turn it over to the Q&A with everyone joining us here. Where do we go from here? What is the thing that you to think that think deserves more attention right now? How can we make sure that we're not having the same conversation in 5 years?
As we did 5 years ago.
Well, I think the first thing we do is we ensure that democracy does not die. Mm-hmm. Because I think we are headed in the wrong direction at the moment. And voter suppression is just one of those examples of it. And so first and foremost, we have to get ourselves together in that regard. And once we have secured democracy as best we can, we can talk earnestly about what we need to do to go forward. We have never been willing to really seriously talk about what the issues are in this country. And Vernon, I remember when I was rereading what we had talked about 5 years ago, you had talked about the fact that we are talking past each other. We really aren't very serious about what we're doing. I'm hoping that what's happening out there in the streets now, what's happening in terms of people making certain that voters are registered, that people are able to get to the polls, I'm hoping that that will lead to some serious discussion about what else needs to be done in the country. I am very fearful because of what I'm seeing, not just in terms of what's happening to African Americans, but what's happening on the border to immigrants, to people who really do believe that there is an American dream that they can be a part of. I have friends who are Asian Americans who are afraid to go out to certain places even before the pandemic because of the way they are treated. This is in the United States. We are no longer an example for the rest of the world. I mean, we were not serious before this about true inclusion, but I thought we were moving in the right direction. And now what I'm seeing is we are definitely going the wrong way. And so until we can get those issues under control that divide us, we are always going to be in this situation, just waiting for the next thing to happen that's going to galvanize us as a nation, just to have it all collapse because we aren't serious about solving the underlying issues.
Well, I started out about, I believe this is a revolutionary moment, as was the civil rights movement. And those are the two that will be the two I will experience in my lifetime. And there's something that good revolutions are both exhilarating, and there's a time for awareness, I think. And I think Edna has hit on both of these. And one of the things that worries me, and before we started, I mentioned this, I know Edna has heard me talk about this way back in 1974 even. I agree with Edna completely about let's get rid of these statues. And one that really bothers me, and should you as an African, there is one to the Dr. Sims is one of those on the State House grounds of South Carolina who operated on African American women without even anesthesia, and is celebrated as this father gynecology and things. And there's not any contextual thing about this at all. And that's how I think, you know, what do we do about if you keep Woodrow Wilson or Jefferson, then you've got to contextualize that there were great words spoken, but deeds are less than what we would want from anyone. The big issue for me is this. It is a revolutionary moment. It's a good revolution. But we have to be aware. And one of my awareness is the renaming of Ben Tillman Hall, do we then say, like when we took down the Confederate flag at first off of the dome of the South Carolina building, then put it in front of it, then took it down and put it in a museum, which is fine. Do people then say, great, we've ended racism? We haven't. All of these things, the statues, our history, they are symbolic of problems that are historically created. We created racism. There's clearly no such thing as different races, but there's such a thing as racism. And we created it by making laws. We started with laws that made it even illegal not to be racist. Segregation, it was illegal for people to be in integrated situations. No one is upset, in fact, that we took down the signs that says colored only or white only, or no Irish allowed. But people sure get upset about a symbol that says the same thing for many people, which would be Confederate statues and other things. That's just to give you a comparative perspective. But what I want us to understand, and why I really believe in history, that is, I take my religion seriously, but if I didn't take my faith seriously, I think history would be my faith. History helped put us in this mess, and history, I think, can get us out of it if people just understand that we were not just taught to be racist, we were legally made to make other people less than their potential. That even if you were a Black veteran in World War II, you could not go to the white school afterwards, a university. You had to go, and some of them were really great schools. I was a historical Black college on the GI Bill, but you could not use the GI Bill to buy a home in a place where it would accumulate wealth so that your family could then go to college after World War II, your children, because of redlining, because of covenants, which went back to 1911 in Minneapolis, where George Floyd once was said that you cannot have a Black person in this neighborhood, which is the good neighborhood, where you invest in a home and then you get the equity and the money, and that becomes the basis of wealth. So whereas, you know, African Americans make a lot more money than they used to, the wealth gap is still there because wealth is passed on, is accumulated, is part of heritage. We never had a reconciliation commission as other places like South Africa have. And I'm hoping that this is part of what will be coming. I'm hoping that in November, with a different situation, I am hopeful and praying that we can actually take advantage of this good revolution that's going on. I think it's being stymied in many ways now and used as a backlash. And I just hope it doesn't work to bring out the negative things. And I don't want to get into politics very much, but that's the other side of the voter suppression. People know better now. I'm not trying to excuse a Ben Tillman, but they know that they can mobilize people. It's hard to separate partisanship and race these days, and by trying to disfranchise through the very same methods. I was the expert witness for LDF in Texas, and the judge quoted me, the in-person voter ID laws are nothing more than a poll tax on poor people as a way to keep them. And it's been shown over and over again. And we are using exactly the same method that were used in the 1890s to disfranchise people or to make their vote be diluted so it doesn't have the meaning of other people's votes, which you cannot do in a democracy. Yeah. Democracy depends on the belief in the ballot and people having the vote.
Yeah. Well, I would also argue that a free society demands that we know history in its complexity and nuance. This has been a great conversation. I'm mindful that we've got 15 minutes and we have a lot of wonderful questions. So I'm going to turn it over to Joan. Some of these questions are along the same lines, but they're about different specific monuments. So I'm going to let you, Joan, facilitate how to ask these questions of Edna and Vernon.
Thank you, Erin. And because we are running low on time, I'm going to do my best to make these sort of rapid fire questions. And I appreciate everyone's patience with me as I do that. We have two questions that were related, one of which is from Tom, who wants to know, should we take Confederate memorials off of all National Park Service lands, including battlefields? There's a bill that's gone through about that. So should we do that? And then the second part of that question comes from Bruce, which is, can we do anything about Confederate monuments that are on private land, or is that just up to the people who own the land?
Well, I'll start. I've always felt that people can do whatever they want to do on their own property. I might not like it, but I have nothing to do with something that's owned by someone else. But if I'm paying to maintain a monument because it's on public lands and it is offensive to me, then I shouldn't have to pay for that. So I would call for removal. Now, if we're talking about a national park, I agree with Vernon that these historic sites are doing a much better job with telling the complete history than used to be the case. And so perhaps with a bit of tweaking of the history, not just simply having these monuments there for people to draw their own conclusions, but using those as teachable moments to explain what this history was behind it. I don't have a problem with that. But something like the Richmond, the monuments on Monument Avenue and those kinds of things, that kind of stuff needs to be removed elsewhere. And so I'm happy to see that they're doing that. That's happening all over the country, and I think it's high time that it did. But that doesn't mean that we're destroying the history. We're just putting it someplace else and being very open about exactly what happened.
And I want to go back. I think you have to look at each one separately. I feel very strongly, as Edna does, about the public property. It really, I get angry and I have to pray about it because I see people around me here. I live in 96 South Carolina flying the Confederate flag, and it's all I can do to not want to go and take the flag down. I've actually gone a couple times when I have friends visit and ask people if they mind removing their flags out of courtesy. Sometimes it's worked. I do think that it's a chance to re-examine our history, but I like the way that like things were done by Mitch Landau in having meetings, which brings in dialogue as we look at specific ones that a community comes to grips with its heritage and its history. We were successful in Greenwood, South Carolina to take away the monument, even though there was a Heritage Act, which segregated the soldiers who fought in World War I and World War II, Korean War, and replace it with one that where the soldiers weren't segregated. And that was a community effort. I think that was one way that we were able to make a difference. The other thing is alternative role models, such as the great Dr. Benjamin Mays in my hometown here of 96. The only monument that exists to an individual now is to Ben Mays, the great theologian, one of the three greatest theologians of the 20th century and the longtime president of Morehouse College, who schooled many, many people. His most famous pupil, of course, being Martin Luther King Jr. When I was growing up in 96, the only historical plaque was to the caning of Charles Sumner by Preston Brooks, who was from 96. So we were great at football because we realized the only way that we were going to get recognized, beat the fire to people. You send messages with what you memorialize and who you memorialize. So I think it's important to get some alternative role models, especially women, recognized as well, because they are giving us alternative models about what democracy means. One of the problems has been, particularly in the American South and South Carolina in particular, we just don't criticize anybody who's ever been elected to office. That was the way it was in the textbooks. It was settled that way in American history. If you were president, you were a great person. And a lot of people still feel that way today. And I think that we got to learn to think critically. And one way we can think critically is be more honest about these people who do have monuments if you can't get them down. And we have ways to do this now. We, you know, with the digital revolution, you could just hit a thing on your phone, you get a full lecture on the horrors of what this person was really like.
May I, before we go to the next question, may I respond to a member of your audience who just wrote that there are many Southern taxpayers who are offended by Lincoln. Let me just say that Lincoln did not fight against his own nation. Lincoln did not hold people enslaved. I think what we need to remember is a wrong was done to millions of people of color. And so when the descendants of those people of color see those people who were wronged, see an image, a symbol of that oppression, then of course we're not going to want to pay for having that symbol maintained. So I think we need to understand exactly what this is all about. It's about oppression, not about my or anyone else's concerns, because I just don't feel good when I see a Southern monument. It is much, much deeper than that.
Thank you, Edna. The next set of questions that are related to each other are about specific monuments and to Vernon's point about canonizing a president. Folks are curious what the two of you think about Thomas Jefferson, the Jefferson Memorial, and the Washington Monument.
Oh, Vernon, I'm going to let you take this one first.
Sorry. Yeah. Well, Edna knows this story. She knows who I'm talking about because he's a friend of both of ours and a dear person. But when I was in graduate school, I really got, oh, boy, did when I found out about Jefferson, because, you know, I'd grown up in 96, loved Jefferson, and discovered that particularly he had a child mistress pretty much. Things like this, not only on slave, I just became furious with Jefferson. And so when I went out to Illinois to teach, I didn't even have my Ph.D. The first class I had, Edna was in, it was like 8 o'clock on a Saturday, wasn't it? Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday. Drove all night from the Army to get there, you know, and I just finished and showed up for class. But I had read a book by a professor at Illinois who is a dear friend, and I adore him to this day. But I thought, this is great. He's right. He attacked Jefferson. Go. I can't wait to meet this colleague. And I get there to discover he doesn't like Jefferson because he's a monarchist. That is my historian friend. And I realize, oh, my gosh, you know, there's a little balance here going on. I am mad at Jefferson from the other side. And it sort of taught me a lesson about you have to look at the whole thing. A man who can write these great words, if he wrote them, you got to wonder, since his enslaved force sort of invented everything for him, he took credit for it. But we're assuming he wrote equality and liberty, justice, those things. That's important. That's important that somebody would write that Declaration of Independence. I had thrown that out. I was so mad at Jefferson, I would have taken a sledgehammer to any monument. But now I look at it and I say, you've got to look at the whole picture of a person. So it's a tough question. Same thing with someone like Washington. Would you have had a United States without a George Washington? It's been interesting. My many, many years in the profession now, Washington wasn't right at the top as he's moved up among evaluation, but how he treated democracy, how he wanted to step back, the sort of father of the country. Yes, he owned slaves, and though he punished slaves and other things, the overall thing is he was willing to free them except for his wife. So it gets complex, but there's a large framework there and you have to decide which of it you're going to accept. But the whole story with Jefferson needs to be told. The whole story. If you're going to celebrate Jefferson, you also say this man did not, or he claimed not to believe in black equality, though he writes all men are created equal. At the same time, he certainly felt himself, or he at the most was attracted, let's put it that way, if he didn't love an African-American young woman who was underage and had children with her and things. And that story needs to be told. What I worry about with what Edna is saying is I can just see a mythology growing up after this election of a lost cause, if it goes away, I hope, with another role model I don't like. there. And I think that's our nature, to sort of make to make more of people than they are. You know, we all have, we're complex. Edna and I know we go round after round on Lincoln. I mean, is a good example. You know, there are African Americans besides Southerners who wouldn't want to pay taxes to have a picture of Lincoln there. And I think that's their right, you know.
Yes, that's true.
But it's a different thing. To me, there's no way you can't look at the larger picture. You would not have a United States if there wasn't for Lincoln. And what I like about the arc of his life, he grew and changed in a direction toward greater equality for all and support for African Americans as citizens, as opposed to some who went the other way. Wilson is a more complicated character in that way. He was much, even though he's from the South, he was much more like Northerners about race relations and things. And you've got the issue of his trying to bring peace to the world, though it failed, and this idea of those things, so about democracy. So you have to look at each one and make those decisions. He's the one who segregates the federal government. It had not been, you know, since Lincoln, it had not been segregated. It's Woodrow Wilson who does it. But it's as much as a reaction as part of being a part of the Democratic Party as him. So it's really complex on these kind of people. When you get into complexity, I think you can have legitimate argument. But there are some people there's just no complexity about. You know, when I was talking about the Civil War, I try to tell my friends when they're flying the Confederate flag in my face that I had, grandfathers on both sides that fought and died for the Confederacy as well. But imagine how you felt at 9/11, or if you'd been around for the Japanese bombing of Pearl Harbor. That's what brought the North into that war. The Confederacy fired on the United States. It was the same kind of reaction. That's when I said, if that hadn't happened, I'm not sure Lincoln could have raised forces to have even preserved it.
That's true.
Let alone, I know he couldn't, to have ended slavery. That evolved when people learned what slavery is really like. It was like the killing of George Floyd. When soldiers got to the South and saw what it was from the Union, you can document again and again and again that they were saying, I don't care about slavery. I'm not fighting to end slavery. I don't care. They were racist could be. They got down South. They got to, and blacks who were enslaved helped them in all kind of ways to win battles and things, even when they weren't soldiers. And they saw what slavery was firsthand, as opposed to what people wrote about it and said about it. It's not all that bad and all this. They became ardent abolitionists. It was civil rights movement. People just didn't believe it was that bad in the South. It was not until newspapermen and television cameras caught dogs attacking children and water hose taking the skin off of people that you saw that. It's not until George Floyd is losing his breath second by second that people believe that this really happens. So I think part of it is just not knowing.
We had a question that will be our last question that I think is really relevant to that, Vernon, and I want to thank everybody for the robust discussion that's occurring in the comments. There's a lot of really interesting points being made, a couple of resources coming up, but the final question we'll sort of ask for tonight is, what role has, we've talked a little bit about George Floyd as a catalyst for the current upswing in the discussion on this front. What role do you all think the pandemic and other aspects of the current situation have had in catapulting this to the forefront of American conversation again?
I think what has happened is the pandemic has actually slowed things down. I think that if there were no pandemic, you would see many, many more people in the streets, and the change is occurring much more rapidly. I think that some people have stayed away because they are truly fearful of this pandemic, as they should be. And so I think that more than galvanizing people to go out into the streets, it has slowed the momentum a little bit. I mean, I know we're seeing things escalate, but I think you would see much more of that if we did not have the concern with COVID-19. And if I may go back, I would just like to respond to the question about George Washington and Thomas Jefferson. The words that Jefferson wrote are beautiful, but the words did not apply to the people who were enslaved, apparently, and apparently did not apply to the women either, or to the Native Americans who weren't even considered a part of this emerging new nation anyway. And by the way, someone asked how old was Sally Hemings when he took her as his mistress. Vernon, I believe she was 15 years old. Is that correct?
I was going to say 14, but you're 14. Probably right. I don't remember, but it was about that, yes.
Yeah, she was a child. Okay.
That's right.
And in terms
what is that?
Of,
I mean, the word you would say is,
Yeah. And so in terms of George Washington, yes, Washington left instructions for his enslaved population to be freed when Martha died, but he could have played such an important role earlier than that. He didn't have to come right out and say, this is wrong, we need to do something about it. He could have used his moral authority, if he had that, during the time that he was president, to try to move the country closer to that kind of equality that Thomas Jefferson had talked about. And instead, what he did was he hunted down people who ran away from his farms. Ona Judge, he never stopped hunting for that poor woman. When Hercules left, the cook, he tried to bring him back to the plantation. So if he was truly someone who believed in the rights of all people, the basic humanity, he would not have done that. He would have just let them go. And in terms of Woodrow Wilson, I don't know what to say about Woodrow Wilson. He is saying some really vicious things at a time when we needed moral leadership, and he did not present it. He did try to do so many other things for the world, but he needed to have stopped in his own country and tried to make changes. And I'm hoping that as we go forward, we will have political leaders who are willing to step forward and do that.
And I wanted to add, you know, Jefferson did not free his enslaved people. That I think is an important point. That was one of the things that was just amazing when you look at this. And I do think he thought slavery was the wolf by the ears because he wrestled with it and they made those choices.
Yeah. Thank you.
I want to say with the pandemic, it also, though, underscores, if you look at the data, how historically African Americans and other minorities have less good health care and are more vulnerable. Once again, how all of this is related, that we just forget sometimes. And it's a complex story, but we have to understand it. And I have hope that people are beginning to understand it in a way they never have before.
I think that's a good hopeful note to end on too. Edna and Vernon, thank you both so much for taking the time, and thank you all for joining us. And sorry, we couldn't get to the comment section, just started exploding towards the end there. It was wonderful. And it was really great conversation happening there too. Thank you all for joining us this evening. I hope that you learned a lot tonight, and there are a lot of resources being shared, and looking forward to having the next conversation with all of you. And I hope you could take this forward and feel hopeful about positive change in our country at this time. And I want to wish you all good health and good hope for the future. Thank you all.
And thank you for all you folks do at the cottage to do a good job. What a great job you're doing. And I think it's making a difference. And I appreciate it. And having dialogue like this, I wish I had a chance to talk to everyone there. And again, I have my own strong views, but I try to be respectful, and I think we have to be respectful of other people's heartfelt views.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and I agree. It's also really important, I think, for historians and public historians and educators to find ways to really work together to make sure that that more complete story and dialogue is happening at all levels. That's a really important partnership. So thank you. Thanks, everyone.